Alrighty. Welcome, everyone, to another episode of Handmade Hero, the show where we code a complete game live on stream. Now, I don't know if I'm supposed to say who it is, so I'm not going to until I get official permission. But I do want to share with you something I received in the mail today, which is that you all, of course, know the Owl of Shame. But I received in the mail the Owl of Shame baby, which is kind of amazing, right? It's exactly like the Owl of Shame, but smaller and cuter. Now, the note that came with it suggested that it should be the Owlet of Guilt. But I don't really know. I think it may just be Owl of Shame baby in my mind. And like when you have something that's only a little bit shameful and it's not as shameful, then out the baby comes out. But when you have something really shameful, then the big mama comes out. And so I'm gonna keep both owls available so that depending on the size of the screw up, I can be shamed to the extent that is commensurate with the mistake. So anyway, thank you very much for the baby owl, and like I said, we'll post an official thank you to the Twitter if it's okay. Like I said, I don't want to say anyone's name on stream who doesn't want to be named on stream, but thank you very much for sending that. It's pretty awesome, and I have a feeling it will show up on the stream the next time I make a baby mistake, which, let's face it, I make a lot of. All right, today we're doing just a little bit more work on our mode switching stuff. Today is day 228, so if you'd like to follow along at home and you've pre-ordered the code on handmadehero.org, you want to start with day 227. And so that is what I am starting with right now. I believe we essentially had everything done, except I told you there was a bug, but it was a bug we can't really hit right now. It's a bug in the fact that we would have some threads accessing a mode after it was already gone. But otherwise, things are pretty much right. We have this like sort of placeholder for our title screen, this red sort of clear here. We gotta get some art for a title screen. And then we go into our cutscene and we have our cutscene kind of going, right? And that's all good. And we can enter the game. And now we can sort of walk around and do our thing that we want to do. We can exit the game now, and it will go back to the cutscene, and it restarts properly now, which is what it should. I think we should probably change it to go back to the title screen, but either way, it's trivial. It's a one-line change, depending on which one we want. And then, of course, we can go back into the game again, right? And so all that feels pretty good, but like I said, there's some stuff that I think we want to address there, in terms of making this a little bit more solid. One of them, of course, is the thread bug that I was talking about, where like we want to make sure that if a particular mode spawns a bunch of threads, we need a way for it to clean up those threads when it ends, so that it knows when it can actually shut down the mode for reals. And the other thing that we need to do is we need to make sure that we can create separate standing modes for doing stuff like maybe I don't know what you want to call it, but like pre-seeding, like the way that we were prefetching the cutscene stuff. It would be nice if we could do something like that as well, probably, because we want to be able to do stuff like when we go to start the cutscene, we may want to be able to prefetch into it, or I don't even know. I don't really know, but point being, I could see there being a way, a time when we would want to do that. So I don't, that might be also something to look into. It might be something also to put off, I don't know, but at the very least, I feel like we got to take care of that thread bug situation. Even though I don't know that we're going to use the ground chunk compositing stuff in the end, I guess what I would say is just because the ground chunk stuff might not be used doesn't mean we won't want to have there be some thread stuff that does happen, right? So that's where we're at the moment. And then I feel like after that gets taken care of, I feel like I want to maybe, I feel like after we come back from break, I feel like I want to maybe go back to the debug code a little bit and finish up the stuff that we did there just so we can have that in place. Because I think we're mostly there in terms of stuff for gameplay code, and I kind of want to start that and have the new year mostly be spent doing new gameplay stuff. And so, you know, we just got a few things left to take care of. Get the debug code in good shape. Get the renderer. Like, we got to put a sort in the renderer and do a little bit of lighting work. And then I think we're mostly good. So I want to just take care of that stuff so we can get on with things. So yeah, let me just quickly sketch out what I think that particular problem is. So we have this concept now of this game mode, right? And so we've got this notion here that says, like, okay, you remember this game state used to be this huge thing, and now it's broken up into different parts. So there's stuff for the title screen, stuff for the cutscene, stuff for the world mode when you're actually playing. And then it has some stuff that persists, right? So all that stuff is the way it is. But if you take a look at how this works, you can kind of see that, well, there's this notion that we, you know, have this sort of game mode or whatever, and then we also have this this notion of tasks with memory, like down here, this tasks that are running that may be working on something specific in the in that particular game mode. And when we close the game mode, we would like that to go away. Now we have two choices of how we can approach this problem. Choice number one is to say that actually we don't ever associate things in this way, right? Like, for example, just to maybe give you a little bit of a perspective on what's happening. For example, in the asset system right now, we have a bunch of tasks that are running to load assets off of disk dynamically. That's our streaming system, right? It's to make it so that we don't have loading screens and don't have pauses and stuff in the gameplay. But you may ask, why are those tasks not a problem, whereas the ground chunk tasks are, right? Why am I not worried about those asset loading things? Well, that's because the asset system is totally decoupled from the game mode. The asset system just knows it has to load assets, and it manages the asset store, and that stuff doesn't have anything to do with what mode you're in. So it doesn't matter whether it's loading assets for the title screen or for the world mode or for the cutscenes or whatever. Those tasks are just doing their thing, and they never depend on any of the data that's in here. They're completely decoupled. So the only kind of thing that we're talking about here is we're talking about tasks that work directly on data that's in one of the game modes. And furthermore, we're talking about tasks because we have another set of tasks, right? Which is the renderer tasks. Why don't we care about those? Well, those tasks all get spawned and stopped in the middle of one frame. They never hang around outside the frame. So when you change game modes, you don't care about those tasks because you know none of them are running. They don't span a frame boundary like that. So the only tasks we actually care about are tasks which access the game's mode state, so something in one of these guys, and which persist. So they'll happen over multiple frames. Right now, ground chunks are the only things we have that do that. So we have two choices. Choice number one is say we're not gonna have any tasks like that, right? We could just say we don't wanna do that. That's an option. And choice number two is that we track them in a way that allows us to shut them down when the mode is changed. That's what we can do. So I don't know which is the better answer there. And the reason that I don't know which is the better answer is because I don't know what we will actually need in the finished game. So my gut instinct normally would be to just probably get rid of them. Because I feel like after having done some of the design stuff, it seemed to me like probably I wouldn't really be able to use the ground chunk stuff much. Because the way the design was going, dynamically creating ground things like that wouldn't probably actually work very well. Or would be, what I should say is, instead of not work very well, it's something that is probably not necessary for the most part. So yeah, it just seemed like something that probably at the end of the day is not really all that necessary to do. So my gut instinct would be to remove them. The only problem is, I don't know if maybe there's something else besides making ground chunks that would, you know, that would span that space, right? Something that would take up, sort of a bigger chunk of that time. And so what I think I would say is the only thing I can think of that really falls into that category might be world generation. And the reason I say that is because let's suppose that the game starts and the player's trying to play the game. since I don't really want there to be much in the way of loading screens, like I don't want to stop the player's experience ever, if generating the world takes 10, 20 seconds, 30 seconds, depending on how complicated and how large of a world it is, if there's a lot of stuff that has to go on to create that world, that's going to be a 30-second loading screen, right? And you've seen this in games before, like, for example, when you try to start a game of Don't Starve, for example. You sit there watching it say that it's generating the world or whatever. And so if we don't want that, what we'd have to do is just start the player so they can start playing in the first little area of the world while in the background we're going through, like, generating the rest of it, right? And so I feel like that is something we probably would want. It seems very logical that we would want that. And that will clearly have to happen over multiple frames. So I feel like that argues strongly enough to me that these tasks have to be treated that way. So I think I will probably say, let's go ahead and support it. Because even if I go ahead and pull the ground chunks out, so the ground chunks are no longer involved and we don't need this for them, I would still need it for avoiding the loading screen in that situation. That's what I think. That's just what I think. All right, so how are we gonna do this? Well, we have this concept of task with memory, and that goes in the transient state right now, right? We've got four different tasks with memory that are happening there. And I suppose really all I need to do is tag these things with whether or not they're going to have to be flushed out in the case where the game mode changes, right? So it's kind of like, am I dependent on a particular game mode would probably be all I would really need to know for that to happen, right? At least that's what I think. I'm not 100% sure, that's just what I think. So let's go ahead and say that we had that. Let's do a very simple version of this first, one that's synchronous and that causes maybe a stall, and then we can look at doing one that's better. And that may get into some memory stuff that I kind of wanted to do anyway. So let's take a look. Let's say we have something that's like task with memory, and maybe I want to do something where I say, like, okay, in addition to tracking whether it's being used here, I'm also going to track something like, you know, depends on game mode. You know what I'm saying? And so then when we do our little task with memory thing, where we have like a task with memory begin, right, this thing here, begin task with memory. When we call that begin task with memory, I'm going to say, you know, does it depend on the game mode? And then when I create the actual task, I'm going to set depends on game mode to the correct value. That's all I'm doing. Again, I'm doing the very simplest thing that will solve the problem. And of course, I should probably also change the definition here. 32 depends on game mode. And so now I can just look and see who uses that. Well, obviously, load bitmap doesn't, right? Load sound does not. Load font does not. And so then we just got begin task with memory in for the ground chunk, and this is the one that does. So now I know which ones do, and we're good to go, right? So now what I can do is say when we are going to clear the game mode, I can do the simplest possible thing, like I said, that maybe isn't the most performant, and I can just ensure that all of those tasks close down. And so the way I can do that is when we go to set game mode and I clear out the mode arena, what I can do is right before that, you remember we have the ability to wait on tasks to finish. And I don't remember exactly how we do that. It's something like do tiled render work. Oh, it's in the optimized version. Let's see here. Render tiled render. There it is. So you can see it happening here, where we do this output stuff. We have platform complete all work render queue.
So,
so what I can do there is I can easily sort of wait for all of that.
I can see that the built-in mic is sort of picking this up. Although I really have no idea what the quality is like. I'm guessing it's pretty poor, because look how much noise is going through there. So that's a bit lower. wearing. Yeah. Can you hear my voice? Spy level noise. Yeah, definitely. Scrap the mic then.
Task index is less than translate count translate tasks task index. Right. So I can do something like that and say need to wait equals need to wait or tasks. Whatever this task is, depends on game mode. So if any of these depend on the game mode, then I will force them to complete all work. Otherwise, I won't. So let's take a look at that. Task with memory does not have an overloaded operator. That is true. Yeah. And now we would just need set game mode to actually get that thing that it needs, get the additional state that it needs. So it would need the transient state in order to wait on that queue. And that's it. Now, it does strike me as slightly odd. Well, like I feel like almost that should have been in the game state struct because it's not really all that transient if it's something that depends on the game mode, I guess, but it's hard to say. Anyway, point being, when we do set game mode, again, that needs to kind of have the transient state come through. And it's kind of annoying to have to pass these, so I do wonder if maybe I should just collapse them and do some fancier footwork there. But either way, I'm just going to do the mechanical process for now, and that's something we can obviously fix or futz with a little bit later. Right. So let's go ahead and put that in there. And now we got to push that out one more because those are going to be in here. Those are going to be lofted up here. And so they need transient state. Like so. Okay. There we go. So. Done. So, in theory, now we are good to go. At least I think. But we do have one other thing that I want to look at. But let's go ahead and see if this works right. Okay, so there we go. Here's this coming into the game. Here's this exiting out of the game, right? Here's this coming back into the game. So that's all good. I may also want to make it so that when you exit out of the game, instead of playing the intro cutscene, it plays the title screen, if that makes sense. Oops, not there. But here. So in, where is it? It's actually in world mode, I guess. When we do this, when there's no more heroes left, I would like at that point to go back to the title screen because you know, that just makes a little more sense, right? So there's one more thing that I want to look at, which we did sort of silently before, and I kind of want to make sure that we actually go look at it now. And I'm going to show you kind of a little trick. So here we go back to the title screen, right? And then we can jump into the game, title screen. If you let the title screen skip, it'll go to the cutscene. And there we go, right? That's all there is to that. So anyway, point being, if you'll notice, we hit F5, it takes a while before that fade out starts. And that's new. If you remember when that actually happened, that happened when we first added clear to zero on push. And what I suspect is happening is since we are clearing all of our memory to zero, probably a very large allocation that happens gets cleared to zero due to our automatic clearing now that we probably don't want to do. Now, I suspect that I can cheat without actually using any profiling by using debug break all. So if I just run the game and do break all, I should be, hey look, I should be able to break in the, that giant clear of the chunk. And hey, you can see exactly what's going on here, right? You can actually see that it's asking not to clear to zero. And this is still going to clear it to zero, right? So in this thing that's making the empty bitmap, that's going through all the ground buffers, it's clearing them all for no reason whatsoever. So that's just kind of, yeah. I mean, you see what I'm saying, right? And so I feel like that's something we probably want to address, and I would like to address it now before it gets any more out of hand. And I think you can also see, like this right here would clear a giant block. So I want to address that. And here's how I'm going to address that. Since we've got time on today's stream, before we head out for Christmas break, I want to address that. And the way that I want to address that is I'm going to change the way that push works. So the way that I want push to work now is I want push to take two things. I want it to take the alignment and whether we clear to zero, because we just straight up made clear to zero be a thing. But now I want to make some notion of how this stuff should work, right? So what I'd like to do is say, okay, there's going to be a new thing, which is like push params or something like that, like arena push params. And what that's going to do is the arena push params will say something like, oh, okay, you know, what's the flags, arena push flag, something like that. Arena flag clear to zero. You know what I'm saying? And then it will also have a thing like the alignment. So the alignment will also be, you know, kind of baked in there. You know what I'm saying? So that way, when you do whatever it is that you're going to do, there's this concept of the sort of alignment is going to be baked in there in some way that makes sense. And so, and the flags will be bundled with it as well. Okay. And so then what I'm going to do is say, all right, let's say there's something like inline arena push params, default arena params or something like this. And all that does is say params flags equals arena flag clear to zero, alignment equals whatever that default memory alignment is, right? I'm going to get rid of that, turn params. And now, instead of memory index alignment, these are all going to take arena push params as their parameter, and they'll default to default arena params. Does that make sense? Hopefully that makes some sense, right? So then in here, when we use alignment, this is just going to be params alignment now. Otherwise, it's exactly the same. And now everybody who was doing the alignment stuff before will do exactly what that guy did. They'll all take this, and so that stuff can be bundled when you do the push. And I'll show you why I wanted it to bundle like that instead of adding an additional parameter, other than the fact that you can see it's kind of convenient here, the way that I'm doing this, you know, for initializing the defaults. But that's, we'll get to that in a second. And so then what we can do is we can say if params.flags and arena flag clear to zero, then we clear to zero, but otherwise we will not clear to zero. So that now gives us an ability to clear things or not, depending on how we want to do it. Right. Okay. So now, actually, this effective size for, I actually can just go ahead and pass that through directly, which is kind of nice. And let's see, sub arena is also going to take the params. So this will be arena push params. Params equals default arena params, and there are the params. Here we go. And so now I think we're in pretty good shape. Okay. And so we can now do something like align no clear can now create sort of this custom set of very convenient phrases that look very readable and tell you exactly what your push is going to do, and it'll all kind of flow through properly, right? So now we've got our default arena push parameters, but now we can also do like that, what I just said, where I've got, okay, I'm going to make one called align no clear, and align no clear will take the alignment. It will produce one of these, which will be set up to do whatever it is that does. And then we just make sure we set all these the way we want them, and everyone says which one of them they want to use. So there's align no clear. That won't align it when it does what it's going to do, and it's all good, right? Now, the hilarious thing is I believe we actually would probably want them to be cleared because we call clear out the mixer channel. So I should probably do a thing that's here like, are we sure we don't want to let this do the clear? Because that might be faster than this, but I don't know. So anyway, point being, that's what I'm talking about. All right. Similarly here, when we do make empty bitmap, here's a push size that's trying to do it again. Since we have this clear to zero thing, and we've got clear bitmap just calls zero size. So really what we could do is get rid of clear bitmap. I think we don't need that anymore. My guess would be we don't, and I think we can get rid of it. So now all we would have to do is say, well, okay, we know we may or may not want to clear this. So we can just say clear to zero. If we're going to clear it, we'll do one way, and if we're not, we're not. So we can do align clear and align no clear, and both of them can be aligned to 16 if that's what we want. Make sense? So yeah, something like that. We could also do something with a Boolean. You know, you could imagine something like this if we wanted to. And that might be fun, because then we can say, oh, either we're going to do a clear or we're not, right? And then that would just be like, oh, okay, so align 16 clear to 0. Know what I'm saying? So that's kind of handy too. All right, so let's keep going with that. What I want to do now is I want to just go find everywhere that we did a push, right? Which is quite a few places, but not an intractable number. And I just want to take a look at how we were passing them and make sure that we're using, now that we've got new features, that we're actually using them. So here is, for example, a thing where we do a clear to zero. That's probably fine because that's just an array of ground buffers. Those ground buffers aren't that big, I do not think. So that's all fine. That has nothing to do with it. And neither does any of this. These are just the actual code. Blah, 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 blah. Don't care. Don't care. So there's a push size, and this is the push size where we do a push, and then we immediately write to it. So that is presumably something where we want to do no clearing, right? We don't want to do any clearing in that. So that does the push size, then it would do don't clear, and it writes to the entirety of the thing that it allocated. So let's see about this. Oops, that was actually something I wanted to look at. So that's fine, because whoever does the sub arena can say whether they want it cleared and what the alignment is. So that's all good. So let's step back through there. Push struct for task work. That is literally just getting overwritten completely. So that does not need to be cleared either, because it's a load asset work that gets overwritten completely. This one looks like probably you might as well clear that one, because it looks like it's actually setting it up here, so that's fine. Again, same with this guy, probably doesn't need clear. Creating the game assets, that should be cleared. Insert block with a push size here, where it's taking however the size is, that definitely doesn't want to clear. I bet that was what was taking most of our time, because that's the whole asset store getting zeroed out for no reason whatsoever. Here's our push array with the asset file. That's something I think we might as well clear. That seems pretty straightforward to me. Asset type array is getting read from the file immediately afterwards. I don't know whether we want to clear that or not. That's a really good question. If the read file failed, then I suppose we would file error out. So I suppose that means We don't really have to clear it. So I'll go no clear for that guy as well. And let's take a look at these guys. So we've got asset counts, tag counts. I don't know if we want to clear these or not. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to leave them as getting cleared, to be honest. Sometimes I find it's just better to clear, better to be safe than sorry. So we'll see if it creates any problems doing it that way, but if it doesn't, I'm going to let those guys clear. So those are no clear already. Here's a bitmap push call that doesn't relate to the memory system. That's just it happened to have push in the name. This stuff for the cutscenes, again, those can get cleaned out. Don't care about those at all. These are welcome to clear themselves. That's a push bitmap call. Here's push font. Again, that's unrelated. Push rect, unrelated. All of these guys are other stuff. There's push struct. Get a clear. Again, that's debug view. That can get cleared. So here, again, these are all fine to clear because those are not performance sensitive anyway. So it's always, like I said, better safe than sorry. I'd rather clear them out. And all the debug stuff, I'd rather just have it clear. That seems like fine idea. Okay, and so let's see. In the render group, we have a push struct for the render group. That's fine. That should get cleared. That's all good. We've got a push size here for the max push buffer size. That should definitely not get cleared because that's a push buffer, and the push buffer is getting overwritten all the time anyway. That should not be cleared. I don't think that's a good idea. So let's see here. Push render element. That should take care of it itself. So let's keep going. That is just talking about the push buffer. And let's see. Push bitmap, push render element, push bitmap, font, rect, blah, blah. These are not actually things that push memory. Push render element, push struct. Sim region, when we do begin sim, so there's the zero struct on sim region hash, which is the majority of it. So I think what we want to do is just let it clear the whole thing. That seems like a better call to me. Then we got next in hash, that can clear out. That seems reasonable. Again, I like having those cleared. I like the extra safety in case there's some forgotten variable. That's always good. Again, create world, that can clear just fine. Entity block, also fine. Pairwise collision rules, also fine. Push struct, what is this saying? Not world arena, change using the fundamental types arena. I am going to let that to-do stand for when we look at it before, but yeah, that can easily be cleared, no question. So can that, for that matter. Sim entity collision volume group, push struct, that seems fine too. All of that seems pretty good to me. All right, those are some other bitmaps. Fill ground chunk, that can definitely clear. Mode arena, that's fine. See, bitmap rect outline, again, nothing really in there. That's all just graphics stuff and down. All right, so now we've kind of told it what to clear and what not to clear. You can kind of see that we've got this one that I didn't define yet, that's just don't clear. So we now need to make sure that we actually have that one. So we've got no clear. That doesn't take anything. All it is the default with nothing. All right, so now these guys, what do they actually do? So align no clear should take the alignment and do it. This guy should take the alignment and do it. This guy should presumably use the default. So we could actually even just do default arena params and then just set the flags to basically just not have arena flag clear to zero. So really we just say whatever the default was, you know, we let that do its thing. And that seems pretty fair to me. Yeah. In fact, we could do that on all of these. We could just have it be that we clear that flag. You know what I'm saying? So that flag gets cleared, and then we overwrite the alignment, I guess is what I would say. This guy kind of needs to rewrite it, but it could do something. It could actually just do this. Right? So if you clear else... you don't. So that way, every time we do it, we actually start with whatever the default is. So if we added more flags to the default, these guys would just inherit those flags, which maybe is a better idea. I don't know that it is or not, but I'm just going to say that for now, we'll do it that way. Okay, insert block. That's wrong. That's got to get parentheses around it, obviously. Fix that. And now I think we're in better shape. So hopefully, and I don't know if this is true, hopefully we'll get closer to running faster. Okay, we do, which is good. Again, that's something I've been wanting to do for a while. And hopefully that's something that, now you can see it runs much more snappily. So that's all good. So we're in good shape there. Yeah. All right. Good deal. So where are we on time? We had about 15 minutes left on the clock, so we've got about 20 minutes left, is what I believe that we have. And so one other thing that we could do now, I'm trying to think about whether 20 minutes is enough time to really do it. I wanted to go ahead and start making the concept of the memory arenas flow all the way down to the operating system level, because I really wanted to do some stuff where, for example, we could have arenas that can grow where the operating system just gives us more memory as we grow them. And the reason I wanted to do that is, for example, first of all, we may want to just run on the PC that way, for example, because since the PC has virtual memory and people may want to run really huge worlds or something, we might want to just let them use all the memory in their machine if they want, right? Whereas on something like a Raspberry Pi, maybe, where we've got a specific amount of memory we got to fit into, we wouldn't do that. But more importantly, even if we always make sure the game only runs within a certain fixed allocation that starts at the beginning, because we just want to do it that way, even on the PC, our debug system should never have to run through that, right? The debug system is a separate set of memory, and that should be able to run through some growable thing that just ask the operating system for more memory, and who cares, right? It's the debug system. It never ships on the user's machine. So I did want to add that, but in 20 minutes, I think that might be a little bit, it might be a little bit tight, I think. Just my guess. So I'm not sure exactly what we want to do there, but that definitely does seem like something that I want to do eventually. So the question is, what do I want to do now? And I don't really know. That's a really good question. One thing that we could do, you know what might be fun? What might be fun is to start fixing the renderer sorting. That seems like something that might be fun. And there's a couple of things in the renderer that I wanted to fix that was related to that. So what we could do is implement a really, really brain dead sort, like a bubble sort or something in the renderer, so that when we come back from break, we can, you know, replace it with a good sort or something like that. That might be fun, right? That's that I could see that being a thing, right? And I don't even know that we would get to that if we just started that. That's the other thing. So maybe that's a bad idea too, because if I started it, we probably wouldn't get a chance to finish it, because really the hard part about the sorting is going to be figuring out how to structure the stuff in the push buffer in such a way that it can be sorted conveniently. So there's that, which is also kind of weird. I don't know, maybe it's not that hard. I'd have to think about it. All right, let's just take a look. I don't have any better idea of what to do, so we might as well look, right? I mean, if I don't have a better idea, let's just take a look. So what happens at the moment, right? You know, we've got this sort of this concept of rendering all our stuff, and we kind of do a thing where we go like, okay, you know, when we do our tiled render, we call tiled render group to output. That's not what we call. We call something a little lower level than that. Or a little higher level than that first, right? Tiled. There it is. So we call tiled render group to output. So I was right, it's in the wrong function. That is what we call. And what that does is it sets up a bunch of thread work where the renderer can run on multiple threads, and it lets the platform layer go, you know, spawn, make sure all those guys can do the work and sort of spawn it off, right? And so each one of those is going to call, like the function that that's going to call is this thing right here, doTiledRenderWork. And that doTiledRenderWork function, I suppose that's probably in our optimized doTiledRenderWork, or is it not? Where is it? Here it is. So that doTiledRenderWork, that's going to go ahead and do, and you know what's kind of funny too? We still do our alternating even odd lines thing, even though we were going to do something where that would be hyperthread based, but we never actually did that. I don't know if you guys remember that, because we never really went and did any super serious optimizations of the renderer, because somehow the simple optimizations we did ended up making it run at 60 frames a second, 1080p, which is crazy. These machines are so darn fast these days. So anyway, yeah, that's kind of hilarious. We should probably just stop doing that scan line alternating. It's probably just slowing us down at this point. In fact, I wonder if we should just time it and see if it is, like, whether it gets faster to not do that, right? I feel like it just would. I'm so torn. There's so many things we could be doing and so little time. We only got, you know, 15 minutes left on the clock here. It's ridiculous. Anyway, but yeah, that's kind of funny. Like, we do render group to output, and we've got this concept of the even odd things, and we don't even use them, and I don't know that we ever will, because I couldn't think of a good way to actually launch the hyperthreads to, like, interleave together like that, because you can't really synchronize. You don't even necessarily know when two hyperthreads are going to go pick up something from the job queue. So, yeah. Let's just pull that. Do you want to just pull that out? It just seems dumb. You know what I mean? It just seems kind of dumb. Let's pull it out. Let's just do it. Let's just see. So yeah, like let's figure out what our frame rate actually is at this point. Let me go ahead into Handmade. Let's see, Handmade build, I guess is what it is. Build.bat. Let's go into build.bat and turn on Handmade internal. Because if I remember correctly, all this stuff was still working. It's just a question of not supporting the hot code reloading because we hadn't finished some of the stuff with strings. So what's the problem here? No constructor can... Oh, get arena size remaining. Get arena size remaining is taking the alignment value of 1, I guess. So I guess I would just do no clear 1 or something. Or align no clear. Something like that. All right, so there we go. There is our rendering there. And you can kind of see that we're a bit slow on the cutscenes, which is what we would expect because we're doing all the overdrawing, right? And I suppose the other thing we should do is take out our lock loop for now. So if I go into Win32 Handmade, we had a thing where we were, you know, basing on the time here till we have real VBank support. I said I was turning that off. So let's take a look. So that's what our current timing is, right? It's like 36, 33, right? So again, I'm not actually going to try to optimize this. Once we actually want to do optimization, we need to do something where we're actually taking really consistent timings, not just kind of like messing around and seeing it. But I just wanted to make sure that the frame counter was up there to make sure that I didn't do something really stupid, like change the even and odd thing and end up like super tanking our frame rate. So I just wanted to make sure we kind of knew roughly what it was, so that when I do this, because I wanted to pull this out because we're not really going to use it and it could only be wasting time, that I'm not doing something that I don't actually just not understand and to turn out to make things much worse, right? So I'm going to take that get even thing, that even oddsness thing, and I'm just going to get rid of that entirely. Okay, so we got draw rectangle and draw rectangle quickly. Draw rectangle takes even. I'm going to take a look at what even's actually doing. So all it does is offset. Yeah, so all it does is say, oh, if we were only supposed to be doing even and the min was at 1, I'm going to advance. But I'm pretty sure we can just get rid of that, right? And now we would just do plus plus on these guys directly. And we should be good to go, right? And then draw a rectangle quickly is our optimized one. There's our even. If I look at for even, it looks like it's still just basically doing that. And then when we, again, when we advance row to row, we would have to do something to make sure that we weren't going by twice. So there's row advance, 2 times buffer pitch. So I think, again, all I would really have to do there is say just regular buffer pitch. And then the row advance should be correct, right? I think. Function does not take 8 arguments. Is that true? Draw rectangle quickly. Do we predefine that? We do. Let's get rid of that. So there we go. And let's see if that works any better. It's beautiful, isn't it? Look at how beautiful that is. Well, we totally nailed it, guys. Good job. Looks really good. I think it'd be hard to argue that we totally did that seamlessly. All right, not a great showing. Not fabulous. That was not really a very good job. It's true. But don't worry about it, you know? Just let's not worry about that. So, okay, let's take it a little bit slower here and see if we can figure out what I messed up. So the clip rect is properly set here because we were doing evens and odds separate of that. So we know we're still doing our region stuff, and that should be correct. These guys don't care about even odds at all. So we only have the two functions, draw rectangle and draw rectangle quickly, right? So what we should be able to do is we should be able to just like look, I should be able to find this by inspection. If we don't, I'll hop into the debugger. This guy shouldn't have done anything differently, right? You can see that it's pretty much straightforward. It's just incrementing. Oh, we didn't change the counter. That's the problem. On this guy, we're still incrementing y by 2 each time. So that would do it. Yeah. So there we go. And if anything, that definitely did get a little faster. But again, like I said, we're not really timing it. So I feel like, but it's the same basic values as it was before. So I feel like that's a safe thing to remove. We don't have to care about that weird even odd thing anymore. So that's good. All right. Let's see what's going on here. Yeah. So that doesn't look any different to me. I don't know if it looks any different to you. But like I said, we'd have to really time it to be sure. But I don't think we want to proceed with that interleave thing because it just seemed like a dumb idea. But maybe not. Who knows? Just wanted to double check. So, okay. Inside the render group, then all I wanted to point out is in order to put ourselves in a position where we're going to be able to sort these things, we need some way of knowing like what we're even sorting. So when we do that that sort of do tiled concept, right? So in here where we're like tiled render group, what's it called? Do tiled render work, that guy. So when we do our render group to output, that's going to loop through all of these guys as we go. And it's sort of going to, it's just going to draw, it's going to do the rendering operation immediately whenever it sees the guy. And so right now what happens is our stuff just gets drawn in whatever order it's shown there. And so what we would have to do instead is figure out a way to like draw these in a different order, right? In some other order. That's really the long and short of it. And so in order to do that, we need some way to sort them. And in order to sort them, we need some way of looking at them as a, you know, as a whole. We need some way of being able to compare, you know, one to the other and swap their locations. And typically we usually want to do that in a way that's fairly random access. And as you can see from the way we did it here, our push buffers are packed. So we advance by a base address each time as we go. And if you look at what we actually have for things that are in here, one question might be whether that was actually a good idea or if that's even necessary or if these things could be the same size, right? Because essentially all we've got and, you know, possibly all we're going to have is just fixed things that could have been fixed size, right? Like all of these things could probably be the same rough size and then we wouldn't, then we would just have our actual push buffer would be something we could just sort in place. You know what I mean? And that seems like possibly a good idea. However, that said, it may also be the case that we don't super care, because it may be the case that what we actually want to do is just first pre-cull everything to see what falls inside each tile, and then only sort, have each thread sort only the contents of its bucket, right? Because remember, the way our renderer work is we break the scene into tiles, and each thread renders a different tile of the screen. And so what we could do is just say, like, oh, we'll do a first pass, and that first pass builds like a little array of the things that actually need to get output. And then from there, we sort those, right? That seems kind of compelling to me. I feel like that's probably the way we should do it. So I feel like we might want to start with something like that. I feel like that might be the best idea. Yeah. All right. So let's see what we would have to do for that. So when we do our do-tiled render work, when we actually do that, we would need some way place to store that information, right? We need a way to store that. And lucky for us, we actually know the maximum number of things that we could possibly have. And so I feel like we could easily do something where when we do our push buffer, like in here, when we do this stuff where we say, like, okay, you know, here's our push buffer, we could also do a thing where we just count as we go through. We could do like push buffer element count or something like that. You know what I mean? So however much stuff is in there, we can just track it. And so when we do push buffer size, like when we do allocate render group, and we set the push buffer size to 0, we can also set the push buffer element count to 0. And then every time something gets pushed, you know, every time a render element gets pushed, then when we do that render, when we do that push, we increment the element count. So that way we would know exactly how many elements there actually were. And does that ever get reset? Just curious. Oops. It does. So we could also say that, right? So it gets cleared on end render as well. Seems fair. So that is a pretty reasonable thing to do, I suspect. And that way, when we go and we're actually going to start the do-tiled render work, we would know when we prepare our work struct, like this thing, we could give it a space for its temporary storage. So that sorting that it needs to do, we could just say, all right, you'll get a place for your sorting. And I don't know what that be, but it'd be, you know, whatever, the tile sort entry or something like this, right? And it'd be like an offset, you know, push buffer offset, and like the sort key, something like this. And we would just say, okay, you know, when you are called, you have your sort space. You know, you just get some space that you can use for sorting, and that'd be pretty straightforward, right? So when we call render group, tiled render group to output, or I guess really in either case, we create that sort space. So that would just be like, all right, the work sort space is temporary memory. So we're going to need a way to get temporary memory. I forget how we did our begin temporary memory. Forgetting stuff. We just do it off of the memory arena. And so I assume that's going to go on the transient arena there. And so we want some place to do that work. Yeah. Well, I'm just trying to think of exactly how we want to do this. Because the sort space has to happen in both cases. And I just want a nice clean way to do that. You know, essentially what I'm thinking is something like, okay, this guy, well, you know, honestly, I think it's just this. I think it's just that these guys have to be given the temporary arena that they're going to use. And I don't actually see any, this guy doesn't actually do anything with an arena usually. So I think that's going to have to be something that you just pass in the temporary memory, right? So the arena where you want it to get its temporary memory from. And so then all it would do is it would say like, okay, you know, at the start of this, I'm going to do begin temporary memory on the temp arena. And then I'm going to end it here, right? And that's really it, I think. So here is the sort entry. And I need however many of those as we have render elements, right? So I need to say that the render group push element count or whatever, push buffer element count. I need to get space for as many entries as there are elements, because there may be that many of them. So we could do that, and that's good. Push array needs to take the temp arena as well, I think. And so that same thing needs to happen in our tiled one. And I don't actually know that anything weird has to happen here. It's basically exactly the same. So this is going to just be, oops. This is just going to take the same stuff and do exactly the same thing, only instead of allocating one of those, it's going to allocate one per. Right? So that's just going to say, all right, for each of these guys, the work sort space is going to be that, and we're good. Okay, so these guys just have to take the transstate tran arena, I believe, is really all that has to happen, so that they can allocate their temporary memory from it. Oh, although this guy, since he's in a task, he would have to get it from his own memory. This right here. Okay. So that's fine. And tiled render group to output, this guy gets it presumably from the actual tran arena. Not that. There we go. And wait a second. Where was that? Why do we have two calls to tiled render group to output? Do you understand that? Ah, right, the debugger calls it. Okay, that's totally fine. And I don't really know, so in the debugger also, again, like I don't really know very much about how we want that guy to manage its memory, but presumably since it's just using the temporary memory right inside that window, it doesn't really matter, and it can always use like the debug arena for that, or it could use either of these actually. I don't think it matters at all, because it's only within that tiled state that it would ever care. So I think that should be fine. And off it goes. All right, so I'm going to end it there, and that's actually perfect because then we're not really getting into sorting at all, so it's not like a cliffhanger or anything. But now it's good because now we have a situation where these guys in their tiled render work, they have space for sorting, and so really what I can do when we start off is we can take this render group to output stuff, we can go ahead and make that right into those entries, and off you go. Off you go from there. And it'll take a little more time to do, but should be okay. So I'm going to go ahead and go to the Q&A. We could take a couple minutes of Q&A here. And then that'll be it for a while. And when we come back, we'll get our renderers properly sorting, which I think would be a good idea. Sergey RGB, could you tell us roughly how the expanding arena would be implemented? Yeah, it's totally trivial, right? So, it's super, super trivial. The only thing you do is right here, instead of this assertion, you replace this assertion, and instead you just do an if. If you can't satisfy it, you just call the operating system for more memory. That's it. So the only complexity comes in implementing the temporary memory thing, because that has to rewind. So there's a little bit more there, which you'll see, but it's like stupid simple, right? Insofar as, is the lower level memory arena thing you mentioned for PC basically just what malloc virtual alloc does? Not really, because virtual alloc and malloc actually do memory coalescing and stuff. They're a little more complicated than, memory arenas are like the simplest form for the most part of allocator, and malloc actually tries to like reuse blocks and allows you to free and allocate in any order and all that stuff. So that's a worse problem, right? That's a little more of a serious thing. Simon Denton, I got the K&R book to learn C. Any other useful resources? I take online stuff with a grain of salt. I don't know. I'm the wrong one to ask. Probably the stream is the better people to ask. Casto 5, is interlaced the same as interleaved? Yes and no. Interleaved is just a general term that means that you're doing two things alternating. Interlaced is a very specific term that refers to a way that displays work. And it refers to the display methodology of first displaying all of the even rows or odd rows, depending on which parity you start with. First displaying every other row, then jumping back to the top and doing every other row that you didn't do, right? That's very specifically interlaced. So interlaced is a very specific term. Interleaved could mean anything. Like interleaved can basically mean anything that alternates between two things is an interleave. So interlaced, very specific, talking about displays. Interleaved could be talking about anything. Connor Rents, what should I do with my life while Handmade Hero is on break? Well, I set you up to implement a sort. Implement the sort. Beat me to it. Everything is there. You should, in 2 weeks or however long it's going to take, it should be a little less than 2 weeks probably, or something like 2 weeks, before I will be back here and able to program on this machine again. You should be able to get all that working. Cooper Caleb, which algorithm do you plan on using for sorting? I don't know. We'll start with a bubble sort, which is the stupidest kind, like the most basic kind. And then we'll try implementing one of the more complex sorts, like a merge sort, and we'll actually see what the performance is. Because sorting is weird, like sometimes stupid sorts are better than smart sorts, depending on the circumstances, so it's kind of hard. Elvin, why are we running in a Windows application using WinMain instead of a console one? So the reason is because if you build your Windows executable as a console, then when people launch it, it spawns a little console window, always. There's no way to get rid of it. And so it's just really unprofessional to have a game that starts up and it has this, its window and the stupid console window there, right? So if you really want that, you can. There are some ways of getting around it. And what you do there is you actually look to find your console window and then you hide it so no one can see it. But again, since we don't need that, I don't understand why you would ever do that. Like, I'm not sure why you wouldn't just build it as a regular Windows application instead of a console application, right? Cuber Caleb, why was the interleaving added in the first place? It was added because I was thinking it might be a good idea to have hyperthreads where each hyperthread was rendering and alternating lines, because then they would hit the cache optimally on that core. But I never could really think of a way to force the threads to actually run in that way. So I think it was just kind of a waste of time. Insofar as, how many to-dos are there in the code now? I have no idea. Not that many, I guess. Let's see. Is there much overhead to spawning the render threads every frame instead of keeping them around? We do not spawn render threads every frame. We keep them around. And yes, there would be quite a bit of overhead spawning them every frame, which is why we don't do it. Culverfly, do you always start with software rendering when working on games? No, I don't ever start with software rendering. I did that strictly so that people on the stream could learn how a graphics card works. Because if you just call a graphics card and say, draw my graphics, you never have any idea how they actually work. And so only people who used to have to write renderers from before the GPU days, like in, you know, 95, 94, they all know how they work, and it gives them a lot of insight into graphics, you know, stuff. And so I wanted to make sure everyone had that experience, at least once. For New Year's, can we get a marathon? Maybe, I'll think about it. Ryan Rees, can you do really smooth animation in GDI without VSync? I don't know these days. Windows is very different nowadays than it was when I started programming on it, and I haven't played much with the Aero compositor, so I don't really know. I really have no idea. It's not that relevant for games because you have to go through the GPU eventually for games more directly anyway. Like, even if we kept our software renderer and never did a hardware renderer, I'd still want to do the small bit of code to get us running through OpenGL so that we can get VSync, right? So I really just don't know much about what would happen if you decided not to do that. Simple question, but how do you forward declare a struct in pure C? I have typedef struct foo foo. How do I forward declare this? I tried typedef struct foo foo, but didn't work. I don't know that you can do that. I'm sorry, I don't know. I probably did know at one point, and I probably forgot. M1EL, do you have any optimization for not blending transparent pixels? No, we don't. So right now, this is like, again, this is one of those things where, like, it's just crazy how fast computers are. So it's sick that this thing runs at 30 frames a second, basically. Because this is like, I don't even remember how many, 10 levels of overdraw. It's drawing everything. So like everything behind the house is getting drawn like 10 times on top of each other, right? And there's no optimization in there for that right now. So if we wanted to, we could speed these things up dramatically, right? We could probably make these things render at 4 or 5 times the speed they're rendering at now. But it's just crazy how the CPUs are just so fast that if we wanted our cutscenes to run at 30 frames a second, we don't even have to do that work, which is crazy. It's just sick. Yeah. It's so bizarre. Let's see here. Caleb, once you have sorting implemented, do you think you will change the renderer to draw front to back? We could. We might. It's not a bad idea, like I said when we talked about it before, and we could do some optimizations there. But yeah, I don't know. It's a good question. Elvin, is there any way to use a console instead and hide that? Talking about Windows applications from Task Manager, etc. I'm not sure what you're asking. Is there any way to use a console instead and hide that? Hide what? Act binary, can you give a quick overview of the way memory is managed at the moment, push arena, begin temp arena, etc.? Well, yeah, I mean, there's really very little to it. The way that we manage memory is extraordinarily simple. And like I said, that's kind of why I always say that it's not that big of a deal. Like, it takes a little bit of work on Handmade Hero because we don't really have that much code for it, and I have to write it all on the stream. But once you've written some, it's usually pretty easy to just ignore memory management almost entirely, and there's just a few places in your software where you care about it. But in terms of memory management, right now all we do is we just say we have a block of memory, and it's however much you want to use for the game. So let's say you want to use a gigabyte of memory for the game or something. And then we just partition it into slices. So we say, like, oh, this part will be used for the assets or something. This part will be used for the game or whatever. And technically, we do this a little bit early. So really, instead of giving the game the whole 1 gigabyte, what we do at startup is we actually say this part of it is one chunk, right? This is a chunk. And this is a chunk at the operating system level. So we have this thing called, like, the permanent arena and the transient arena. But then all that happens is once we have it, we just start stacking things up on it. That's it. That's all we do. So a given arena is just a big buffer of memory. We start here with nothing in it, and as we put things on it, we just push them down, right? So we just keep pushing it down. So here's a thing, here's a new thing, here's a new thing. It's just a stack. And the way we handle temporary memory is we just say, remember where the stack pointer was, use all this stuff however you want, and then jump back. So when you're done with it, we just pretend it never happened. And then the new stuff that gets allocated will write over it. That's it. There's nothing else there. It's the simplest darn thing. All right. Alfwitch, are you still using .bat file compilations? Yes. Here's our build system. That's the build system. All right. All right. I think that's just about it. So I'm going to wrap it up. Let's go ahead and save all this up and close it on down. All right. Thank you, everyone, for joining me for another episode of Handmade Hero. It's been a pleasure coding with you, as always. If you would like to follow along the series at home, you can always go to handmadehero.org and pre-order the game, which comes with the source code even as we speak. So every night I upload the latest changes, and you can play around with them. There's also a forum site you can go to where you can ask questions or view our annotated episode guide. There's a Patreon page you can subscribe to if you want to support the video series. And there is a Tweetbot, which tweets the schedule if you want to catch the series live. And the next time we will be live will be after Christmas break. I will not be here, so I cannot keep streaming, unfortunately. I would if I could, but I can't. So keep an eye on the Tweetbot to find out when that is. I suspect it will be sometime around New Year's. So check back around then, or just make sure you subscribe to Tweetbot and it will tell you. That's about it. Hope you guys have a good holiday season and doing whatever you're doing. And I will see you guys on the internet in the meantime. So take it easy, everyone, and I'll see you in 2016. Thank you. Mm-hmm.